Hello and welcome to News Click. You're watching Present, Past and the Future. Indian cinema rarely treats historical characters in a balanced manner. Either they are excessively valorized or depicted as villainous. Often, socio-political framework of the present is superimposed on the past. Political players do this all the time. After all, forces of populist nationalism draw strength from falsely constructed notions of the past. History, it is said, can be slave to anyone. Since the film industry's beginning, filmmakers have repeatedly turned to either biopics of past rulers or on real or imaginary romances. In recent years, historical films generated huge controversy. We remember the protests preceding the release of Padmavat. Even the film's title was altered. The recent film Panipat has its shares of controversy and has been yanked off theatres in Rajasthan. It has angered the Jat community for its depiction of Raja Surajmal as a person who betrayed the Marathas at a critical moment. The film also angered the government of Afghanistan for the unidimensional portrayal of Ahmad Shah Abdali. The same was in the case of Alauddin Khilji in Padmavat. Filmmakers have really speaking no regard for history. The past is simply a yarn they can spin to register profits. There is no denying that the Third Battle of Panipat was one of the most important events of the 18th century. The last of the epic battles near Panipat, it took place during a period of transition. The Mughal Empire had gone into a tailspin by then. The defeat of the Marathas in this battle, in a way, hastened the establishment of British hegemony. Much of the controversy surrounding the film stems from inadequate understanding among people regarding who fought whom and what was the nature of alliances. Were Marathas fighting for the idea of Hindustan? Whenever enthusiasm needed to be bolstered, did their troops motivate themselves with the battle cry of Har Har Mahadev? Was the Maratha expansion in the north and west a sign of Hindu assertion to herald the end of Muslim India? Answers to these questions and several more provide clues to unravel the process of Indian nation building. I have with me Tanuja Kothiyal, who teaches history in Ambedkar University. Among other courses, she teaches a very interesting course, Understanding the Past, Myths, Epics, Chronicles, and History. There certainly is a lot of these in the popular understanding of the final battle of Panipat. Welcome to this program, Tanuja. Let me begin by trying to understand the backdrop of the Third Battle of Panipat. You have a situation, what I was telling, that the Mughal are going into a tailspin. You have the rise of Maratha power, and the battle is being fought at Panipat, which is far away from the real, the seat of power of the Marathas, which is in Pune, and Abdali, there in Afghanistan. Understand this theater.
So, what we need to understand about Panipat or the Battle of Panipat is that it's happening at a time which is very, very complex. The Mughal Empire is disintegrating. We have a series of emperors coming one after the other with actually very little power. It has shrunk in terms of the territory, but it has also shrunk in terms of the kind of influence that it exerted on people who held power in different parts of the empire. So, there's Rajputs. Who are regaining their strength after the decline of the Mughal Empire. Then you have Jats who have risen. There are various other factions that have come up. There are Marathas in Deccan who come up because of the kind of conflict there is that exists between the Mughal emperors as well as the Dakkani sultans in an earlier period. So Marathas are a result of that polity. The rise of Marathas is a result of that polity. And increasingly what happens is that different factions, including the Mughal emperors, begin to depend upon militarily powerful factions to help them control the northern India as well as have power. So Mughal emperors do not have their own military power anymore. And they begin to depend upon, one of them is of course Marathas, but also on the Afghans, also on Rajputs and different factions. So it is a time when different factions are actually fighting to gain more power, to exert more control on the Mughal emperors, to become powerful by themselves, and they all come together in this period. So Marathas basically, when they begin to expand northwards, there are some areas where they establish their own kingdoms. So Malwa is one. So as we know, Indore, Baroda, Gwalior. So these are the kingdoms that they establish later on. But then there are some areas in Rajasthan and in Gujarat
where they basically work with the local.
They work basically. They have they what they establish is a tributary state.
Right.
They just get
the tribute. Taxes.
They collect taxes, the Chauth and the Sardeshpur.
Right.
So they collect taxes, and in return, basically they intervene wherever there is a conflict. So with the decline of the Mughal Empire, we find that there's a lot of internecine power struggle that takes place, for instance, among the Rajputs. So Bundi, Mewad, Marwad, these are the important areas where actually Marathas intervene. Whenever there is a conflict, the Rajputs either call the Afghans or the Marathas to intervene on behalf of the claimant. So one claimant will call Afghans, the other will call Marathas. And that's how basically Marathas begin expanding northwards. On the other hand, after Nader Shah's invasion, Abdali sees himself as the descendant or as a claimant of whatever Nader Shah controlled.
Okay.
So he wants to control Punjab, which he sees as his own legacy. And that is how basically different factions, including people like Safdarjung and all, who are, or Najib Khan, who are entrenched into Mughal politics, they all come together in this
in this
arena, and then they start plotting against one each other.
You know, I the way I was actually talking about, I obviously have seen the film. Now, what struck me is about the film is that they are presenting the film, the Marathas for coming and actually all the way and coming and fighting with the forces of Abdali is because they want to integrate and knit India.
Right.
They also look at things from a very modern political vocabulary.
Right.
Abdali is referred to as a ghuspetia. This is something which is of very recent origin
very
in the political sphere. You know, this entire thing of an illegal immigrant, you know, ghuspetia, that is what it's called, but it is used in this case. Now, the portrayal of how what the Marathas, trying to understand from you as a historian, you know, that what was the basic nature of the Maratha, you know, confederacy or, you know, the empire, and how was it different from the Mughals, you know, that were they actually driven by this idea of making a Mahan Bharat? The Hindu Padpadashi, as later on Savarkar, you know, tried to use.
See, one thing is that history writing or history as, you know, depicted by cinema, as we are seeing, is not really about past. It is how we want to see the past through the eyes of the present.
Because it helps us give strength in the present.
Exactly. Because that's how we imagine. So we want to imagine the a continuity to the idea of the Hindu Rashtra into the past that we are trying to build or
so
trying to see.
So we ignore the fact that
absolutely.
Shivaji
so,
had very important Muslims.
Not in, just you know, that, that Shivaji is a part of the way in which Mughal polity is rising in Deccan.
Exactly.
He's a result of that. He's a result of that. Yeah. Right. And Marathas at that point of time,
but
very
that
frankly,
reality will not be convenient to a certain political narrative now.
That reality will be difficult, and it's a nuanced reality. There are no heroes or villains.
It's not black and white.
It's not black and white. There are no heroes or villains.
Right.
There are people who are fighting, there are shifting alliances, very frankly.
Right.
And if we look into histories of different parts of India, whether it is Rajputana or whether it is Odisha or Bengal, actually you get a very, very complex picture of the Maratha presence in that. Marathas are seen as predatory fighters. So Bargis, for instance, in Odisha and Bengal is a very, very villainous figure. I have, for instance, seen various exchanges around Rajput-Maratha conflicts where there is this very serious conflict happening because Marathas are, you know, they just raid and they collect taxes without sort of any kind of mercy or anything else. So there's a complex picture that you have of how Marathas are themselves seen in the 18th century. For us to actually think about Marathas as somebody who carry this idea, the germ of this idea of a Hindu nation, or forget the Hindu nation,
somebody
the idea of a
basically ending
of how we see India today. You know that
Muslim
there is
rule,
exactly
1200 years of Muslim 1200
rule. Muslim years of Muslim rule, but also like what we today see as India, as if there was an idea that is something that Shivaji imagined.
So
back
was
in
it imagined or not?
Not really. At that point of time, very frankly, as I say, people are working through a series of alliances where they ally with various kinds of people.
And they keep on changing.
These alliances are shifting. These are different kinds of alliances. So, Surajmal, for instance, is allying with Marathas earlier, but later on he's shifting an alliance, and that's...
Why does he do it?
See, at that point of time, one is, of course, the Marathas actually do not have much sympathy in northern India at this point of time.
Because, as you said, predatory.
Yeah, because of the predatory nature of the Maratha polity.
They're not actually coming here to do anything to this land.
No, exactly.
But basically, they have a home there and they're strengthening their home.
They basically collect tribute.
Right.
And they intervene as mercenary forces whenever it is required. Okay. And at that point of time, as I say, everybody is trying to...
It's
a different form of plunder.
You know, instead of taking it in one go, you're taking it, ensuring a...
Exactly.
Creating a system by which you get annual returns.
Returns. And at that point of time, everybody is basically looking out for what works best for them. So, Surajmal is looking out for what works best for him.
And at that point, when he decides to jump ship, it's no longer helping if he continues to be with the Marathas, because he realizes that they are not going to win this battle, and he wants to be on the side of the victor.
He's trying to establish his own kingdom. He's trying to establish his own territory. So, from his perspective, from his point of view, it is a perfectly logical and a justified step that he is taking. So, this idea that everybody is fighting for India, and therefore, if Surajmal did not help out Marathas at that point of time, he was somehow betraying the idea of India, is something that you would call anachronism in history. It does not work like that. You do not see what is there today in the time that has gone by, because the time that has gone by has its own logic. The way things work at that point of time are very, very different.
You know, there is the very interesting narratives in today's Maharashtra that post the third battle of Panipat, for the Marathas it was a century of gloom, that it was possibly the most humiliating experience in their history, and it took them a lot of reinvention of the past to be able to present it as to that they were not really humiliated, but they actually gave a very valorous account of themselves in the battle. They got outwitted because of the sheer brutality of Abdali. So instead of saying that we lost because of our own inability, but then saying that we lost because the other person, you know, had no qualms and no moral value while getting into a battle and, you know, violating various norms. Now, obviously, they were outnumbered. They definitely had inferior
military technology. Yeah.
But, you know, as a historian who studied also the military thing, how do you look at it? That what was the real reason for the Marathas suffering such a humiliating defeat?
See, the Afghan army was far better organized. They were far more organized in terms of what kind of strategy were they going to use, what kind of, say for instance, the use of cannons, the use of horses, placing and all other kinds of things. So, it is a...
In the film, like the show, you know, that while the Marathas also have cannons, but the Afghans are using mounted cannons.
On
camelback.
Yeah.
And that gives them a certain advantage.
See,
that is what they
have a military, in terms of military technique, they have an edge. And that edge helps them. Also, it is also the way in which alliances are forged. Ultimately, Marathas are isolated, and that isolation leads to the defeat of Marathas.
In the defeat of Marathas, how does it start changing the political topography of North India and the rest of India? Also, how does it benefit the advent of
the British?
We know that the Battle of Plassey has happened just 4 years prior to that.
Yeah.
So, they are already in a position of being an ascendant force.
Yeah. See, very frankly, it's not immediately after the Battle of Panipat that the
not
Maratha influence starts declining.
Yeah. Till it continues for another 50 years at
50
least.
Years till 50 almost like 1790s. Yes. Marathas are still very, very influential. Yes. They're still very, very powerful. And they have established their own, so whether the Holkars or whether the Sindhias or the Gaikwads have actually become very, very powerful kingdoms at this point of time. Hmm. They are developed.
But they're small kingdoms.
They're small kingdoms. The Confederacy.
Owing allegiance to Pune.
Owing allegiance to Pune, but also these are also again shifting allegiances. Okay.
So not necessarily they are not all going to the Peshwas all the time.
They are not always going to the Peshwas. They are becoming, there's a lot of internal politics among the Marathas that comes
up. So there's a greater what we call in today's jargon regional autonomy.
Regional autonomy. And what we begin to see actually is, so the kind of consolidated Maratha power that we are talking about prior to the Battle of Panipat, that begins to decline. The British, by this point of time, 1765 is when Shah Alam gives away the Diwani rights of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa.
Okay.
So, that's a very, very powerful moment in 1765. In fact, on the other hand, we see that Shah Alam has to be escorted from Allahabad to Delhi under the Maratha protection. So, but the coming of the British, then what means is that British become another power to whom different factions can then appeal for help and protection. So, for instance, in Rajputana, what we find is that very often, Rajput kings see it in a way that we are paying an indemnity to Marathas, we can pay it to the British as well. So, by 1812, between 1812 and 18, subsidiary alliances have been signed between the Rajputs and the British. So, basically, British begin to replace the Marathas in a large way by the beginning of the 19th century. So, Marathas by the beginning of the 19th
century. The
Marathas,
you would say that at some point had begun to replace the Mughals at some point?
At some point, yes.
So, we can say that it was actually Mughals to the Marathas because of disintegration, Marathas to the British because of the defeat at Panipat?
There isn't a direct correlation that just because
not
Maratha,
a cause and effect.
Yeah, it's not a cause and effect. British are rising because of their own reasons. They are making their own alliances, they are making their own, the militarily
they're smarter,
they're militarily superior, they're organizing in a much more different way. And a lot of kingdoms
have a greater, bigger plan, you know, of a clear idea of what they want to do in the future.
Very much. And therefore, a lot of kingdoms in northern India begin to see British as a force that they can make an alliance
greater
with.
Greater benefit to be aligned with them than with the Marathas.
So, we see increasingly that Maratha kingdoms become isolated kingdoms here and there. So, you have the Gaikwads, you have the Holkars, you have the Sindhias, and then of course you have the Peshwai in Pune. But the kind of consolidated force that they were seen as earlier in the later half of the 18th century.
But what about kingdoms like the kingdom of Awadh, you know, for instance,
right,
you know, which plays a very important role in Panipat by siding with,
yeah,
Shujauddala sides with Abdali. And you know, we also say that in the rise of the British, Awadh plays a very important role, especially with the annexation of Awadh in the entire, I think, the 19th century. What happens in the, what we call, you know, the Doab part of northern India?
See, increasingly what's happening is that by one way or the other, by one means or the other, this is before the British decide not to fight the princely states. So, at that point of time, they are still engaging in battles. They're still trying to either purchase zamindaris or get into alliances through which they can control greater areas. And increasingly, we see whether, so basically the whole point like around Awadh is that whole idea of circling Awadh somehow. You know, so, you know, Bengal, Bihar and Orissa go on the one hand.
North, you have Rohilkhand.
Yes, and you have, on the other hand, you have Delhi, right? And in between is Awadh. So, Awadh basically gets circled by the British eventually. And by 1857, by claiming mismanagement and all, they have taken over Awadh.
And Awadh is left with no other option but to...
Awadh is left with no other option, yes.
But just to...
You
know, also... You know, and at least in a notional way, the Mughals continue for another century after that. You know, what happens to the space which Mughals controlled? You know, does it really get divided up into these small kingdoms which you're talking about, or are there, is there any real kind of influences the Mughals have thereafter?
No. So, the thing is that Mughals continue to have not just a nominal, but a very strong cultural influence. I mean, Mughals do not get replaced. There is, ultimately the emperor is the Mughal emperor.
Yes. Right. Even in 1857,
even
it was
in
the
1857,
Mughal
it is
so
the
he
Mughal
remains
emperor.
The notional Badshah of Hindustan.
He continues.
So the idea of Hindustan.
Not just that, you know, very powerful kingdoms are still issuing farmans in the name.
Why is this the case? Though they have no power.
See, I would say that basically because there are too many claimants at this point of time. There are two. The factions are very powerful. Factions are actually balanced against each other. And in that, the balance is maintained by having a nominal Mughal emperor there.
Could it also be because of the symbolic value of
Very much. So
Delhi,
therefore,
being considered to be, the citadel of this part of northern India at least.
It's not just Delhi, but it's the kind of legitimacy that the Mughal emperor claims, the Mughal dynasty claims. It has been there for such a long time from the...
Also because it's very inclusive in nature.
See, the Mughal polity actually rests on including various factions. Hmm. So, whether it is Rajputs and even to a certain extent Marathas actually get included into the framework of the Mughal idea. Various kingdoms, even whether we are talking about Jats, they all get included into it. Hmm. And Mughals continue to command legitimacy to the extent that very powerful kingdoms are still referring to the Mughal emperor. Even if it is nominally, the reference to the Mughal empire is still there till 1857. Hmm. You know, the company, the company is molding itself on the idea of the Mughal emperor.
Of replacing the Mughal.
Of replacing the Mughal
not
emperor.
Not any of the other.
No, none.
Because they're too small.
They're too
so
small.
So, it's only the idea of actually ruling India comes from the seat of Delhi.
If we are talking about an Indian empire, if we are talking about like somebody who actually represents the idea of India, it is the Mughals at that point of time.
Right.
It's not anybody else. That reference remains. The company Bahadur
and the British
is,
are quick to understand this.
The British are very quick to understand this, and British have become too formidable a force by 1850s for anybody to actually, think of actually having a, I mean, of course, there is the revolt. But that revolt is also something that the British managed to crush in the 1857, and that is the end of the Mughal Empire. The rest of the factors, rest of the northern India and various parts of the Deccan actually get divided among various claimants, various kingdoms that come up. There are some very powerful kingdoms like Awadh or Hyderabad, or even the Rajput kingdoms become fairly powerful for a certain period of time, not for very long. But... then, of course, I mean, Mughal, then the British actually imagine different kinds of polities for
so,
different...
You know, you teach as a last question, you know, you teach your students, you know, so if you have to, when you talk about this period and the what Panipat actually did, you know,
yeah.
in a very quick, how do you summarize that, what it led to within India?
What, I mean, very frankly, if I were to think about that, Panipat doesn't have any immediate... impact
right.
on, like, there's no sudden shift that's happening. Alliances continue
like,
in the
yeah,
way
it's
that
it's not
they
like from day to
no,
night or
no.
night to day.
So, I would say that a lot of these landmarks that we'll try to think about, whether it is the Battle of Panipat or whether it is the Battle
so
of
Haldi Ghati. It's not actually a page turner in today's terms.
It is imagined as a page turner at a much later time.
Right.
It is when we start thinking about these events as momentous, as something that caused an immediate shift in polity, we're thinking about it from the perspective of where we are today.
Mm-hmm.
At that point of time, very frankly, Marathas continue to be very...
powerful at least 50 years.
At least another 50 years. Abdali, of course, is defeated, but that doesn't mean that the Afghan kingdoms continue.
The
Rohillas continue.
Sikhs rise.
Sikhs rise, but then so many other factors rise.
Yeah.
So, it doesn't like it... At a much later period, the Marathas are replaced by the British.
So, like many other points in history, it is definitely a transformative...
It's a transformative moment, but that transformation is something that is slow. That happens cumulatively at a later
when
time.
When we look back in the past, we can say out of the 10 transformative events which are happening around the same time, this was possibly slightly more important or maybe much more important
if we were to,
than
yeah,
the others.
If we were to think others. In terms of the three battles of Panipat, yes, it is the most important one.
Yeah.
But if we were to actually place importance on these events that we like to think of, the momentous events, they actually
lead to... Unfortunately,
a
lot of history these days is actually...
yeah.
you know, read or taught as event related and personality based. Thank you for coming and joining me on this program to shed very valuable light on the final battle of Panipat.
Thank you very much.
Revisiting the past is inevitable in India, given how it influences current perceptions and prejudices. It is thereby necessary to ensure that the reading of the past is not done according to current political tastes. In a limited way, we keep trying to provide balance in the discourse to prevent the past from being distorted. I hope we have succeeded in this once again. Thank you for having watched this.